onyame oyɛ ne nneɛma ne mmuemu ne mmuemu ɛbi wo deɛ so ɔde bɛma wo ɛyɛ abotire nka me nyankopɔn da nea woyɛ biara wɔ nim nea woyɛ you shall be the head and not the tail wobɛyɛ etire na wonyɛ nan ɔbɛhwɛ wo so wohuma asɛm obi bɛbisa sɛ na deɛ koraa na ɛkɔ so wɔ awura yi anaa aberanteɛ yi abrabɔ mu obi antumi nhyira aseɛ ye sɛ Asafo Awurade
You glory. We thank you, Father Lord, for how far you brought us. Thank you, Jesus. You said you will lay a table before us in the presence of our enemies. Thank you, Jesus, for how far you brought us. Honorable Adwoa Safo, the Minister for Gender, Children and Social Protection. MP Bakupe.
If you think you have a problem, and the way you are going to operate is to sabotage the party. Now, you are asking for the president to remove the deputy majority leader for you to be a deputy majority leader. I will also go back to America and tell President Akufo-Addo, resign before I come. Yeah. If President Akufo-Addo should yield to Adwoa's demand, I'll also go to America. Then I'll make phone call to Chief of Staff. Well, tell President Akufo-Addo to resign before I come back. Somebody will look at me, Ken Agyapong. He talked too much. Okay, I'm also not coming to Parliament. What precedents are we setting in this party? So please, we have to be truthful. I have kissed there, but it's gotten to this point.
And this, as you say, purely is a long political line.
Political.
Has nothing to do with your personal relationship with her.
No, this is political. Right. I think she's wrong. She should rather apologize to the party. They should stop begging her.
Do you support the cause for her removal?
Yes. But the foundation I've laid clearly tells you that I support for her removal if she doesn't come and sit there and make demands. Prophet, Dr. Mwakuba, what do you know? When she refused to pick my call for 13 times, I tried Sunday, she refused. Wednesday, she sends a PA, calls me, and Adwoa says, if you can help our son's bill. I said, but when I wanted to talk to her, she did not even pick you. Ever since you've been her PA, have you heard that I have argued with Adwoa even one day? He said, no. So why did she place the call to you and not me? I'm not going to give her a dime. And Dr. Mwakuba, listen to me here. I mean, I don't like people like that. Honestly, I have vowed not to insult. Can never blast the beer. Agyapong. Chief of Staff called me. I went there. Said, now this is what she's saying. I swear my mother's grave. Chief of Staff gave me 120,000 deposited in Agyapong's Fidelity Bank account. Please, Amwakuba, what do you know?
So lot has been done.
Yes, I'm telling you. I put the money there in the Fidelity account. Ask her PA if what I'm saying is not the truth. But now we are in opposition. The way Adwoa is treating the party is clearly showing that we are in opposition. And this shouldn't be tolerated at all.
You know, the conversation about her position would not be of great significance, for the lack of a better expression, if there was a clear majority in Parliament. And this has become even more in sharp focus because of the e-levy. I'd like your thoughts on the e-levy bill itself.
You know, my e-levy, I support e-levy fully. Because it's about time black man takes his destiny into his own hands. Black people should stop begging white people to feed themselves. We've been in classrooms with them. Fordham University is a pure white university. About 5% minority, 95% white. but we all receive awards. It clearly tells you that if you think the way they think, you'll be a superior being. So, with this pandemic, that the whole world is suffering from it, who is going to take his taxes and give it to you? Who? So we have to be independent by collecting these small taxes here and there so that we can also run the economy. But if I hear some people argue that we should go to IMF, any government that goes to IMF has failed. And we haven't failed for the good works that we have done in this country. You should applaud Ken Oforiatta. He's not well, but still, yesterday I heard them in WA. All in the name of the country. Ah, please. Now let me explain the e-levy to you. I think there is a problem because yesterday I was listening to Asempa and Agyapa stressed 100 cedis, you pay 150.
You're referring to Agyapa Mercer?
Yes.
Agyapa Mercer, okay.
And yesterday, after GBC, the workers there, some were telling me that, you know, our people don't explain the e-levy well to the masses. Which I disagree because it's like they've been polluted and they don't want to know. But let me take this opportunity to explain. Look, if you are sending 200 cedis to your mother, first 100 cedis is zero tax. The second 100 cedis, you will pay 1 cedi 50 pesos. So if you are sending 300, you are not going to pay 4 cedis 50 pesos. You will pay 3 cedis because the first 100 is free. Ghanaians should get it clear that the first 100 is free. The second 100, making 200 that we are sending, you pay 1 cedi 50 pesos. So if you are sending 300, you pay 3 cedis 50 pesos. If you are sending 400, you pay 4 cedis 50 pesos instead of 6 cedis because the first 100 is free. Ghana Fontien here. We have to listen carefully. Because maybe they are refusing to accept or we don't communicate well. The first 100 cedis you send is free. Now let me tell you,
after that,
the mode of transactions business of late is on our mobile phones everywhere in the world. So what America now is doing is that they call something Cash App. The Cash App, the first $500 is free. If you send $600, the $100 is taxable. They deduct. Now, they call something structuring. Within 24 hours, if you want to beat the system, for instance, I want to send $1,000 to you. Today, I'll send $500.
Then tomorrow, another 500.
Then tomorrow, another 500. When you send 500 today and within 24 hours, you send another 500, it is called structuring. You are trying to beat the system. So immediately it triggers to IRS. They report you to IRS. IRS will not come after you. But at the end of the year, there's a printout to you to go and file your tax. So this is the business transaction you did on your mobile. Some friends are saying that you don't have to compare America. Why not? America, the richest nation on earth, even is applying some form of e-levy. How much more a poor country like Ghana? So surprisingly, we want to know, I know they do corporate social responsibility. I don't doubt that. These telcos, they are charging 2 cedis. And Ghanaians don't find any problem with it, my brother. But when it comes to 1.5 Ghanaians have a problem. These same people are asking, look at Honorable Samson asking for new roads for Bodi. Where are we going to get the money? It's all part of it.
But at 6.8 billion CDs a year, is that what we need to
my brother,
really shore
it's,
up?
It's an added on. Okay, it's better than nothing. Because 8 billion CDs, if you go to IMF, NDC people went to IMF for 1 billion. The structure is 330 million a year. And look at the restrictions they gave them. So in 3 years, going to IMF for 1 billion, in 3 years, 330 million a year, three times, getting you to 1 billion. This one will give you 1 billion times three, which is $3 billion. Look at the difference.
Yeah. Some have argued that the way the e-levy debate is being looked at is largely because it's as though we're pouring money into a container, a bucket that has holes in it.
My brother. Yesterday, I listened to one presenter, 92.7, and I was sad. I got so furious before I got to GBC studio. I was so annoyed. But democracy, we have to entertain everybody. My brother, let me tell you, under MPP government, the development that has gone on these 5 years is unprecedented. Look at the roads being constructed everywhere. Look at factories coming up. Look at school feeding or free SHS. Look at development. Businesses springing up under MPP government. How can you say it's a basket that you pour water into it and it's leaking?
Well, I mean, at the end of the year,
we show for whatever we've done or whatever money we took. Now, let me tell you, until the gentleman sitting here is an eyewitness to an incident that happened on Friday, a cousin of mine, they left on Thursday to Asimfusu and he complained of headache. The next day, he called them early morning to take him to hospital, which they did. When they checked the pressure, it was 215 over 133.
That's very high.
Yes. So they had to refer him to Ridge Hospital, Fusu. And a Kufuadu's ambulance from 215 over 133, the nurse plus the ambulance operators, the equipment in that ambulance, when they got to Ridge Hospital, his pressure had dropped from 105 to 98. These same NDC people that are making noise, very dishonest people, bought these empty ambulances at $70,000. Empty. We are in Parliament. They brought it to Parliament House. That's where they came to park it. Is that what we are seeing today? So in short, what I want to tell you is that value for money, MPP is always better than NDC. Let's go back to President Kufuor's time. And we see how Ghanaians forget so soon. Either we are ungrateful or we don't even see or understand what development is. NDC were bragging with e-blocks. They did only 28. 16 of them funded by World Bank. Kufuor, we're talking of e-block. Yeah, it's only one stretch.
That's right.
Kufuor built 52, Ghanaians should listen, 52 model schools. If I don't know at all, Chufu Praso was one of them because it's next to my constituency. 52. administration block and everything. They shifted them from wherever they are, a new location. And you need to see, 52. NDC, proclaimed to be socialist party. They are just chop-chop. That is why Ghanaians believe that NPP is also going to do chop-chop. And because of the way they believe and understand governance is chop-chop, they inculcate that into Ghanaians and they believe. Why I say chop-chop is that? Where on earth? You are blaming Bawumia. When this interoperability at the Bank of Ghana and the rest, NDC gave a contract for $1.2 billion. And Bawumia did it $4.5 million. Ah, Ghanaians, please give me a break here. We've forgotten so soon. We've forgotten so soon. Look, let me show you. Because it's there. Now you don't see the importance of it. But the ideas, the vision of a leader. Look, under Akufo, we had Movenpick. Under Akufo, we had Kempinski. Under Akufo, we had Golden Tulip renovated. Takoradi. It was given to Western Diamonds before we came and all those things. You have a Holiday Inn. All came under Akufo. NDC in 8 years. With Atamos praising or singing, Mini Anom, Awala Nyimze, Amamazi, Me Nyam Sumfo, and Ameba, Petru Metrodo, boom, 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 boom. What did we see?
But when it comes to petrol, the president, Nana Addo, Akufo-Addo, also said that he was going to drop prices.
Yes, but let me tell you.
It didn't happen.
Let me tell you. Akufo-Addo took over in 2017. When did you experience COVID?
2019? Well, 2020 March.
2020 March. So he didn't even finish the first term. I'm drawing your attention to something. That NDC government, anytime you have NDC government, the global economy performance favors NDC. Anytime NPP comes to power, the global economic performance do not favor NPP. You know why? I'll give you an example. You've forgotten. In 1998, that was the time that the cedi depreciated about 150%. 1998.
Oh, yeah, we had, I think, about 28% of inflation at the time.
Good. Do you know how much crude oil price was? $20.63. President Kufuor's time, in May 2008, it was 147. In June 2008, it was 179.9 cents per barrel. Immediately that we lost power, it dropped to 67. I also ask you the same question. Did Atamels reduce fuel prices? When it dropped from 180 or 170, I have to be specific.
Yeah.
It was 179.9.
Mm-hmm.
Immediately they took over. Fuel prices came to 67. I'm a Muslim, but I'm a Trudu. Boom, boom, boom. Did you see that?
So, in essence, if both Atamils and
Akufo-Addo
say they're going to, the price of petrol is not something that can be made political.
Yes, I agree with you perfectly.
Yeah,
I agree with you.
So we can't be using those. I mean, I get the point you're raising.
So even today, when I was coming,
yeah.
Brent crude is $97.
Inching closer to 100.
Good. And America has predicted in 40 years, inflation has not risen to 7.5%. But because of COVID and because of the money that Trump printed, trillions of dollars into it. I agree with him. I'm not condemning Trump because he needed money for the country. They printed the money. Now inflation, American history, 40 years is 7.5. Europe, inflation was 0.2, 0.3. Now European Union is 4.868. Do you know what inflation does?
What are your thoughts on it?
You know, so what I'm saying is that globally, all nations are suffering. Prices of items have gone up. A price, an item that I was paying $12 in America today in 2020 is now $21.
So the prices have gone up.
Yes.
It's a global phenomenon.
Because of pandemic.
But at a time when, and I'll use this analogy. Okay. Skin you hot. I'm no papa see and skin you and a bit gare. Wasagari alone case you hot. One waka crazy. Now ube fi krumwab or no befi krumwab and what top papa ash and I'm to mwaba na or the abyssy way. That is the sentiment you get from people, that the size of the government is big, we're not cutting waste in certain areas, and yet we're being asked to pay a little more because it's burden sharing.
My brother, it's easier said than done. If you say we should cut waste, give us the areas we should cut.
Size of government has been cited as one.
What is the size of government?
The current estimate of what the government purse cost the Ghanaian, if I'm not mistaken, is comparatively larger than economies within this continent, Kenya, Nigeria, to be precise, whose government budget, the executive government, the executive budget.
Brother, alone, give me the figure.
No, let me give you the figure in a second. But so you're not in agreement that the government is big.
Give me the figure.
All righty. So let me just share this with you. Now, these figures, in comparison with the budget controlled by the Kenyan presidency, as compared to the control by... Okay, so Kenya's economy, and this is from the national budgets of each country. The Kenyan government GDP is at $480 billion. $107. Nigeria is at $480 billion. Ghana is at $70 billion. $70 billion. Yeah. Okay. It's the least in the three. But this is the money controlled by the president. $221 million by Kenya is the least. Nigeria has $387 million. Ghana, $470 million. This is records from our national budget.
Now, tell me the difference. 380 and 400. I can give you $20 million if that's what they want.
But someone is spending...
No. And I'm saying that I'll give you the difference of the $20 million. If it will solve your irresponsible behavior, I can in Japan will give you $20 million.
Who's irresponsible behavior?
Ghanaians. They are very irresponsible. A lot of them. They don't want to work. They are solely dependent on government for a person, even part.
Really?
Of course, yes. You think I'm afraid to speak the truth?
No, I would like for you to speak the truth, but I would like for you to share, you know.
You see?
Where's the evidence that Ghanaians want to depend on government?
Let me give you evidence. This Saturday, I went to my site in Tema. Mm-hmm. On my way back, listen carefully, a woman has hired Uber following my car. I got to a place to buy coconut. I could have chosen to go and buy cheese and beggar as we speak. But I, who pays workers, stopped to buy coconut to drink. Mm-hmm. It's my choice. This woman has hired a Uber following me. When I got out of the car to ask the seller, coconut seller, to give me the coconut, a woman comes out of the car. Hey, madam, what is the problem? I had an accident about 7 months ago. Excuse me. What makes you think at that particular point that I'm standing there, I have money for you to go and do your surgery? That is what I mean by irresponsible behavior. They are so inconsiderate. The Ghanaians make politicians corrupt because of their irresponsible behavior.
Why do you give them money then?
Yeah, if I give them money, some of them are genuine. Like, I pay school fees and hospital bills. But those coming to me and I'm hungry, they're a fool. They're a fool.
But okay, so you do some philanthropy.
Yes,
another
my kids who okay. have 7 A's, 5 A's, 3 A's, I don't have a problem. You don't leave them behind. I pay. Genuine hospital bills, they come 52,000 Ghana cedis, this and that, heart condition, I pay. But people who come to me, they send me message, today, myself and my kids, we don't even have food to eat. You are lazy. Because if you know how my mother worked hard, she was selling on a small table at Okanshi to take care of me. What has happened to Ghanaian women, Ghanaian men today? That everything, politicians should do it for them. And let me state this clearly, emphatically, that anybody who depends on government for his survival will never survive. Well, he will continue to be poor.
At the moment, we're paying 700,000 people with 60% of all the revenue we generate in this country. I don't know, as a businessman, if that makes business sense.
You see, we are paying 700,000 people. And the 700,000 people are all ministers.
I'm not talking about ministers.
Yeah, so what is your problem?
The problem is that...
What
the
is your problem?
Sector, no,
What's your problem? Is the person working for a Akufo-Addo or he's working for the country?
The question
you
is
blessed that you have 700,000 people working.
Really?
Of course, yes.
But we're paying them with 60% of what we're generating.
That is the situation we find ourselves in.
So now, how do we make the pie bigger so that
now
we're paying with that 60% that we pay them? And mind you, the 60% are people, some of them are going on strike. Some of them say it's not enough. Right?
You see, you are making contradictory references.
No, it's not contradictory references
even
at all.
Even the big part, no. the 60%,
but
they are still
the
going
point
on.
I'm trying to make is that how do we make the size of the pie? How do we make this economy big enough to be able to pay the 700,000 people and be able to... And you think the e-levy is how we do that?
Yes, it's one of them. Creating employment is also one of them.